there's lesson two. So we did lesson one on what is catechesis, and this is lesson two. This is your first lesson as a catechist. I'm recommending that you talk about God's plan of goodness, because it's going to take all of the doctrine that we teach, whether you're in first grade, seventh grade, eighth grade, it doesn't matter, and it shows a map of how it's all tied together. And the reason I think every age should do it, so first, second, third, fourth, all the way through, is that basically it never hurts for them to see the whole picture, one lesson a year, and it never hurts for them to understand it's all connected. So it's not just these random things, you know, we have a portion over here, but then we have the mass over here, and then we have, you know, but it's actually all tied together in the mystery of how God is trying to reveal himself to us. So that being said, I like to always start my lessons, which you don't necessarily have to do, but with a short snippet on a saint, because I've noticed lots of children don't know anything. They don't even really know about St. Francis anymore. And like, I went to a school and it was St. Francis Xavier, and I asked the eighth graders who was St. Francis Xavier, and they basically gave me a biography of St. Francis of Assisi. So I was like, okay, so we're not learning about the saints. It's not something that's in the family structure so much. Some families do, but not a lot, so it never hurts. So we're gonna do today, August 18th, we're gonna do St. Helen of the True Cross. Feast day today.
Are we putting this on the big sheet?
No, this would just be in your notes. When I get to the big sheet, I'll tell you. Okay. Thanks for asking. Okay, so first off, she was born. She was of very simple origins. It is believed, we don't really know, that we think she was a bartender. Is basically what her job was when she was younger. She worked in a bar. And the Romans came through, and she met a general, and the general fell in love with her and married her, and he was General Constantius. So he ignored her simple origins. Later, he was going to become a Caesar, which is just below the emperor, and he divorced her and married the stepdaughter of the emperor. So she was left. But she wasn't Christian at that time. So throughout her early life, and they had one son who later becomes Emperor Constantine, who brings about Christianity in the Roman Empire. And he writes the Edict of Milan, which basically allows people to become Christian. The mother of Emperor Constantine, her only child. She converts later in her life, she's in her 60s or so when she converts, and then she starts basically building Christian churches. So after the Edict of Milan, she starts building churches everywhere. She is the one that goes to the Holy Land and finds the True Cross. It had been buried because there had been so many persecutions, and it had been lost for about 100 years, and she miraculously finds it in this field, and then three miracles are performed when they find the cross, so they know it's the True Cross. And they find Christ's crown of thorns and the nails, and she brings those back. She's in her 80s when she was out there building these churches, and those churches still exist in Jerusalem. She built them so well that they're still around, which is amazing. And there's several of them. And then as soon as she returned with the True Cross is when she actually died, and she's buried in Rome. Her son buried her there. So we'll just put our last note. She found the True Cross. And because I like symbols, I think students get really excited when they go into church and they find symbols. Her coat of arms is actually around a lot of places, so if you could draw this really quick. Her coat of arms is a cross, because she found the cross. actually yellow. Yellow is actually considered shallow, and it's like more sin. It's actually not even sin. So that's her coat of arms. Once in a while, you'll see it in church, especially I was even in Texas, getting Texas, and I was walking there, and all of a sudden, the coat of arms of Helen of the True Cross. And who would have thought, you know, like, who would have gone there? Okay. All right. There's our saint of the day. Now, let's go to our large piece of paper. So we're going to take that paper. Basically, you're going to fold it in half so it keeps all our little circles in the right spot. We're going to draw a ton of little circles and fill them. And what this is for is to show how all of what we teach in the church, all of how God is trying to reveal himself, how it all ties together. Now, I'm going to write a quote in here. If you could put it somewhere in the far corner, kind of small, write this quote so it just kind of ties the whole, it's kind of like the title in a quote. So, in the corner, put God's plan of loving goodness. And then put a quote through. Utterly free decision comma God has revealed himself to man. ... His plan of loving goodness formed from all eternity for the benefit of all men. Period. End quote. And that's from the Catechism, Catholic Church, CCC 50. Through an utterly free decision, God has revealed himself and given himself to man. His plan of loving goodness formed from all eternity in Christ for the benefit of all men. So what is that plan? Well, let's draw a big picture of it. So this is your paper. And this is your crease. Up here at the top, so you have your little quote over here. Triangle for the Trinity. So our first. Next, we'll put Trinity equals eternal. Exchange of love. Okay. And most of what we're going to write, we're going to try to keep it in tiny little clips. So if you see how I do the first one, then we're going to put circles around it and connect everything. Okay, so take a little, we're literally, there'll be circles everywhere, so kind of try to keep it as small as you can. So a little arrow. And then in this little circle, which we'll draw after, put first from the Trinity, we teach about divine providence. This is one of the doctrines. Underneath, put a little line. And divine providence is God guides us to perfection. Dips into our life, into our existence through divine providence. He also, point a little arrow over here, forms creation out of his exchange of love. He comes into our lives out of exchange of love. He creates. I put here, create out of love. Also, drawing an arrow from the Trinity over here, he also gives us revelation. Creation teaches us about him, divine providence teaches us about him, and then he's actually revealed himself. So he's made himself known. In the Old Testament and in the New. So, out of creation, we'll arrow this way, we get the dignity of the human person. If we're created from this eternal exchange of love, therefore the human person is good. Evil cannot come from an exchange of love. Love willing the good of others. Under that, put created in God's image. Now, each of these circles is a whole lesson. Obviously, you probably won't be able to teach all of them by the time we put all the circles, but this is just tying them all up. Okay, out of revelation also, so we have creation and then we have the human person. Out of revelation, point an arrow here, comes the law. How we know what to do, what not to do. And these are our instructions. He's revealed them through Scripture. He's revealed them in Christ, Father to the Church. And then out of revelation also comes faith. Also coming out of the Trinity, draw a really big line all the way around here, is a special person that he created, and that's Mary. So she's a little bit out of the ordinary because she was not created, she was created just through creation and everything, but she's special because she's part of the plan of revelation, plan of redemption. Without sin, so she's extra special. We call her sinless and all fair, all beautiful. Because from her, incarnation.
Dogs do not have a conscience. We do. Birds don't have a conscience. Plants don't have a conscience. And that means we are free to choose. He wants us to come to him because we want to be there. That's part of our dignity. Because he gets to choose, therefore we get to choose. And then another little arrow here. And we have, from being a human, we also receive grace. And that's a sharing God's. From the date of the human person, which we're going across our little crease. For God. We are made for relationship. This also sets us apart from the creation. So all these are lessons that should be taught. They're all doctrines that we teach as Catholics. And the plan, the whole picture is important. When this one is the second most important. Your capacity, whether you're 6 years old, 8 years old, 5 years old, 10, 18. Your capacity for God, how far that relationship can go. I mean, you can have a relationship with a pet, but it's nothing compared to a relationship with a spouse or with a brother or sister. Okay, though, from freedom and conscience comes one bad circle. So we're going to make this into a square, and that's sin. And that's rejection of God. If we're free, we have to be free to do what's wrong, too. Or we're just robots. So put that one in a box. From the incarnation, we need to fit a few circles down here, so we'll try to smush it. Over here, let's put, from the incarnation, we get the Paschal mystery. And that is Christ's life and death. Sin to this. So from incarnation to Paschal mystery. And from the Paschal mystery, we get the church, and that's how we get tied in as Catholics. We get scripture. And tradition. Then we have the second coming. No matter what age level you teach, they all want to know about that. And then the last is glorification, or basically heaven. So circle around the church. Paschal mystery, Christ gave us the church through the cross. And scripture comes from the church. The church actually compiled the books. All of our faith leads to the second coming. Christ will come again, and then union in heaven. All that from the incarnation. Okay, and a few things over here. So, from the church, we get the sacraments. When in the upper reads, when you're talking about justification, comes here too. wants us in heaven. But only through participation in these, only when you receive the graces, the Eucharist, baptism, only then do you actually get theological virtue of hope. Okay, also from these virtues, sacrament, leads to a life of virtue. This is when we act as God's children. We receive Him in the Eucharist, and then we're able to be like Him, because virtue is to become like God. It's not possible without union with Him. And how do we receive union from Him? Well, from the Eucharist. The Eucharist comes from the Church, which came from the Incarnation. So it's all tied together, but you can't have the virtuous life and its richness without the sacraments. From a life of virtue comes the gifts of the Holy Spirit, also from confirmation. Then leads to the doctrine on love. It's interesting, lots of times when you like learn people teach about God, they jump to love right away, whereas we're saying, oh, you teach all these other things, and it builds up to that's why He loves you. Or sometimes if you just say God loves you, God loves you, I notice when I'm teaching that they don't believe it, because they're so broken, families are broken apart, so that they don't believe there's real love. You have to kind of build it up so that they learn all these things and experience Him in the Eucharist, and then the Holy Spirit can step in. He can do whatever He wants, though. The Spirit enables us to love with His power. So you're practicing virtue, you're participating in the sacraments, you're receiving the gifts of the Holy Spirit, your love is deepening, and prayer, speaking, communing with God, is just a natural result. And then that leads to sanctification or holiness. Which leads to glorification. Which leads to heaven. Which then is the Trinity. So basically, this whole book is going to take all of those and show you how to teach each one of those. But this is the plan. This is what God did. When He revealed Himself in creation, He revealed Himself in the Scriptures, He provides for us, and then it just starts to, when you're looking for Him and learning about Him, and then when the students start to see this, then they're like, oh, that's why I got to go to church. Oh, that's why, you know, it just gives more richness to it. And then when you're reading the Scriptures, and then realize, okay, we're very biblical as Catholics. And when I do with the students, I would just base this out, but then I would